One of the most important things we can do as doctors with keratoconus is to detect and diagnose it early. The reason why is because we actually have a procedure that can stop or at least slow down the progression of keratoconus, which is a progressive condition, meaning it will get worse over the years. And so this is usually the first treatment or therapy or procedures that is brought up with someone with keratoconus is to have something called corneal collagen cross-linking. So we're gonna talk about this and other current keratoconus treatments, but also how corneal cross-linking maybe opening some other future procedures, future treatments for keratoconus that otherwise wasn't really possible before corneal cross-linking was a thing. And we'll talk about that towards the end of the video. Corneal cross-linking is a medical procedure in which it takes a riboflavin photosensitizer or vitamin B2 and repeatedly drops that under the surface of the eye, and then UV light is actually directed towards the surface of the eye, specifically UVA. And that riboflavin sensitizer absorbs that UVA and actually creates new collagen bonds within the matrix of the cornea. Mainly, it's stiffening that cornea, making it more structurally sound so that it doesn't start to bulge or progressively bulge like it does with keratoconus. Sometimes you might hear the analogy if you're wearing a really stretchy shirt or maybe a mesh shirt with see-through holes in it and you can kind of move it anywhere, stretch it a little bit. It's kind of like turning that stretchy shirt and making it a chainmail shirt. So you have actually changed. It doesn't really stretch or anything like that. And so that's the procedure, the process of corneal collagen cross-linking. The whole procedure takes about 30 minutes where the top surface layer of the cornea, the epithelium layer, is removed. This is called epi-off corneal cross-linking. And then about every 2 minutes, a new drop of riboflavin is placed on the eye, while the whole time the UV light is directed towards the surface of the eye. And this has been shown to be very effective at slowing down or even halting the progression of keratoconus. So this is very important to have a discussion about with patients with keratoconus, because this should be the first thing that we can think of to treat keratoconus. And then once that's done, we can start looking at treatments that can optimize the vision. Now, this is one thing important to note, that corneal cross-linking doesn't improve the vision. The goal is not to improve the vision with keratoconus, but only to halt or stop the progression of keratoconus. And that can be a tough pill to swallow from someone with keratoconus. But you really do need to understand, it's important to stop the progression, definitely want to do it, but it's not there to make the vision better. And that's why we'll talk about the treatments now that can actually make the vision better. Now, the people that have very mild keratoconus can actually have really great vision with even glasses or soft contact lenses. It really does depend on the severity of keratoconus, but there are a lot of people out there that can obtain really great vision. But if that keratoconus does progress, gets in a little bit more severe stages, maybe higher mild or moderate stages, then sometimes glasses just doesn't quite do the job, doesn't correct the vision enough, or even normal soft contact lenses. And that's when you shift into what's called specialty contact lenses. Now, there are a few specialty contact lenses that are specifically designed for keratoconus or irregular corneas, and they actually can be customizable in the shape and curve to try and customize it over that coned cornea. And a lot of people can actually do quite well with these soft lenses. Again, depends on the severity. If the severity is a little bit more, then you start talking about hard contact lenses or rigid gas permeable contact lenses. RGPs have been available for a long time and a long time for keratoconus with great options and actually giving really great vision. And really the magic of RGPs is that it can create what's called a tear prism. There is a layer of your own tears that fills in the gaps between the contact lens and the coned cornea. And you wouldn't think this would be a big deal, but it actually is what really helps the vision probably the most out of anything. With your tears filling in some of those gaps, this does create a little bit more of a regular surface cornea. And this allows for the smooth transfer of light through the corneal surface so that it can actually be focused to the back of the retina even better. And there are many different designs of normal RGPs that have been around for a while. There are hybrid contact lenses where you have a central RGP or a central hard contact lens with a soft skirt. This can help with comfort, and you can also customize this as well. There are even larger RGPs, semi-scleral lenses, different designs of hard contact lenses, depending on the severity and what might work best for the patient. Now, probably by far the most common or the most favorable contact lens for doctors to fit right now are scleral contact lenses. Scleral contact lenses are actually quite big, and they actually rest and fit on the sclera of the eye, the white part of the eye, and it completely vaults the cornea. And what's nice about this is it kind of takes the cornea, that coned cornea, out of the picture, and then allowing that tear prism to fill in all the gaps between the contact lens and the cornea. And this can be really successful and actually give people great vision. In fact, this is probably one of the areas, at least with me, as being an eye doctor, that is my favorite, is because a lot of times, a lot of people with keratoconus just don't have good vision. They've tried contacts or other contact lenses and glasses. And sometimes when you actually fit them with a scleral lens that works, it's really enjoyable and rewarding to actually see the improvement in vision and the satisfaction of that patient. So scleral lenses, probably by far one of the most favorite for doctors to fit, just because they can be really well. Another modality that's been out for a while is something called a piggyback modality, where you actually fit with a soft contact lens first, and then a RGP or hard contact lens that fits right on top of the soft contact lens. This can help it be more comfortable and more successful for the patient. That's been around for a while, and so you might hear of people that have had piggyback lenses. As far as surgeries for keratoconus, there has been one that's been around for a while, and this is called Intax, or intracorneal contact lens ring segments. They're little C segments that you can actually place within the corneal tissue. And the idea here is you are trying to push out the outsides of the cornea to flatten the cone down, to try and make the surface of that cornea a little bit more regular shaped, to kind of take out that cone. And within that, there are different variations of that surgery, different types of intacts and implantable rings and C shapes that you can get, depending on the doctor that you go to and the type of procedure that you need. And then for those patients that are in a more severe state of keratoconus, there is a corneal transplant option. Now, a lot of times when you hear someone having a corneal transplant, or sometimes they'll say, I had an eye transplant, they're talking about a corneal transplant. And so a lot of times people say, hey, I thought they were doing eye transplants a long time ago. They have, when we're talking about corneal transplants, where the cornea actually does come from a donor or donor tissue for that transplant. And there are different options to this, and really, like I said, more of a severe case. This is where the cornea or the keratoconus has been so bulged out or so severe that it might actually be causing scarring on the cornea. So no matter what you do with glasses or contact lenses or scleral lenses, because that scar is there and the cornea is so damaged, that it's just not going to focus no matter what you do. And so a lot of times the only option is to have a corneal transplant to get rid of that scar and that damaged cornea. Options here are a penetrating keratoplasty, or a PK. This is a full corneal transplant. This is usually for someone where it's very severe and usually all the layers of the cornea are being affected or they're damaged, and so you really need to do a full transplant. Another option is a deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty, or DALK. This is just the top layers of the cornea, maybe the outer layer and the inner layer of the cornea that does get transplanted, where you just leave the inner layer. If the inner layer of the cornea is still fine and not damaged, then you only need to transplant those two, or those outer layers of the cornea. And then there's an endothelial keratoplasty, or EK, where you transplant the inner layer of the cornea if that's what is actually damaged. Usually the two options here are DSEK or DMEK. Okay, like what I said, what's the future of keratoconus treatments? Now that we have corneal cross-linking, what doors have been opened for potential treatments that hopefully will be more readily available in the future? So because corneal cross-linking does strengthen the cornea, this does open doors. Now, with keratoconus, usually that cornea was very fragile, very weak and thin, and so it made everybody worried and hesitant and wasn't recommended to do any type of refractive surgery or surgery on the cornea that might even thin it further or weaken it further. Now, with corneal cross-linking, because we can strengthen those fibers, then it does kind of open the doors of possibly using laser or some way we can remold that surface of the cornea to help that cone shape. One option is called CTAK, or corneal tissue addition keratoplasty. This is actually where a little designed segment of human tissue can actually be implanted into the cornea. The tissue is actually molded and designed from doing a corneal tomography or a 3D mapping of this person with keratoconus and finding out where the cone is and where they might put extra tissue to flatten or make the cone or the shape more regular. So they actually create this little tissue by using a femtosecond laser to design the shape of it, and they use the femtosecond laser to cut out or laser out a channel into the cornea where they can implant this tissue in hoping of making the surface more regular and improving the vision or the outcome of vision by using contact lenses. Another possible future option is something called TGPRK. Now, PRK stands for photorefractive keratectomy. This is an alternative to LASIK. This is a procedure, a refractive surgery that people do to improve their vision. But a TGPRK is a topography guided PRK. So where they actually take the map of the cornea of someone with keratoconus to find out where the steep parts of the curve and the cone is and where the flat parts are, and then hopefully they can use that data and use it as a data-driven PRK to form and know where they can perform the PRK to make the cornea more regular shaped. So you're not necessarily doing PRK to do a refractive surgery to correct the vision. You're doing it with the goal of reshaping the cornea to a more regular shape in hopes that you can actually improve the vision and improve the correction of the vision with contact lenses. And hopefully down the line, this video will be completely out of date with a lot more treatments in the pipeline and different treatments that hopefully have become FDA approved that are available for people with keratoconus. I do see a lot of different talks of different treatments. And so if you want me to do another video about possible treatments that are coming up or some treatments that are currently being done in studies right now, let me know. I'll do a full dedicated video just on that. But for right now, if you want to learn more about keratoconus, check out my playlist. And if you have any questions, leave them in the comments. I'll be down there answering them as the best as I can. Stay focused.